I'm a guardian of truth, or so I claim. But funding's the trigger that makes me play the game. I exaggerate the results of the medicines we design. A placebo effect, but the grants keep flowing in line.
David Helfand has a Santa Claus beard and mustache, just to be clear.
It is cool, though.
Yeah, I keep, yeah. I just keep, you want
in
to nestle
December,
up to
you
him.
You must get so much.
And he smells
so
good.
TSA guys always say, do you work in malls?
I know. No, I work in the North Pole, which is almost not there anymore, right?
Scientists are also responsible. I mean, the level of hype that goes out with press releases when you publish some paper, mm-hmm. is completely out of proportion to the result. You'd see the reproducibility crisis.
Tell me about the reproducibility crisis.
All right, so in
now, by the way, now you're talking about a problem in the scientific community.
Inside the scientific
community. Let the public alone for the moment.
Right.
Let's just mind our own house.
Right.
Okay, go.
So, Amgen, some years ago, did a study.
This is the biochemical company.
Right. And they took 53 studies that were not just published in peer-reviewed journals. This was on cancer, for cancer, looking for cancer drugs.
Okay.
53 studies, not just published, but highlighted in the editorials of the issue of the journal they were in as potential major breakthroughs. And they put a whole bunch of people on it, put a whole bunch of money in it, tried to reproduce them. 89% of those studies were irreproducible.
Wow. That's bad.
That's bad.
I'm going to say that's not a good number.
So just to be clear for people to know it, how when a scientist uses the word irreproducible, that doesn't mean they couldn't figure out the experiment. It means they did the experiment, but did not get
the same result.
That's what irreproducible means.
That's right.
And so if you don't get the same result, then one is wrong and the other's right. The other is wrong, the other is right, or they're both wrong.
Right.
But they both can't be right.
We should consider how objective is science. Religion is just a belief, but science is objective facts. And scientists are supposed to have superhuman objectivity. Superhuman because man is not such a rational animal, as I've already discussed. So the idea that scientists are completely objective, their knowledge which they pursue and promote, it's just delivered as it is. Scientists don't have ambitions, hopes, fears, or any other emotion. Scientists can tell us everything from the tiniest subatomic particles to space far beyond. Scientists don't believe in God, but seems they're arrogating to themselves some godly kind of position. Scientists are people. Yes. They have their limitations of their personality. There is such a thing as politics in academia, scramble to get known, recognized, fashions come in and out, and the need for funding. If you want to have a job in research, you need funding. You've got to go along with what's considered acceptable to research. You have to make an impression on the funders. There is peer group pressure among scientists to be atheistic. You may say, well, why are so many scientists atheists? Doesn't that show that the more intelligent people are atheists? There is such a thing as groupthink. We know that there is no God because we are scientists.
This guy from Yale decides that he's going to really impress our Cambridge supervisors, and he announces that, well, that recently, because of his deep investigations, he had become an atheist. And, this really hip young supervisor in our department leaned across the table and he said in a loud voice that everyone could hear, he said, well, of course you're an atheist, but what else are you that makes you interesting? So I decided I was gonna not share my worldview, at least not right out of the chute. But interestingly, that same supervisor in tutorials about Newton told me, wagged his finger at me, and he said, if you miss Newton's theism, you've missed everything.
It's without bias. Dr. Brown develops a new cancer treatment that she thinks is as good, if not better, than the current treatment. To find out if it is better, she needs to test it. The new treatment is called Treatment A, and the current treatment, Treatment B. She asks people with cancer to take part in a trial to compare the treatments. and gives one group the new treatment and the other the current treatment. To make sure there is no bias, the groups need to be as similar as possible. So, the groups need to have a similar age range of people, they need to have similar general health, and to have had similar treatments. If the two groups are too different, it might affect the result. Also, neither Dr. Brown nor the patients can choose which treatment they have. If Dr. Brown chose, she may subconsciously put the sicker patients into the current treatment group and give the new treatment to the fitter people, making the new treatment look as if it worked better when it really didn't.
It's known that what the experimenters hope to happen or expect to happen are known to affect the results of research in psychology and medicine, and what to speak of parapsychology, which is a pseudoscience, according to Wikipedia. That's why researchers, they often use blind methodologies.
This is a problem. Just recently, a very energetic psychologist rounded up a couple hundred of his colleagues and tried to reproduce 100 and some, I forget how many there were, experiments that had been published in behavioral psychology.
Okay.
You know, of order half of them could not be reproduced.
Half of them couldn't be reproduced.
In the so-called hard sciences, physics, biology, outside of medicine, chemistry, it's just assumed that blind methods are not required. But it may be that experimenters are not so objective.
There is no requirement, cosmic requirement, that your research will ultimately be shown to be correct.
Okay.
Most research is shown to be either unimportant or uninteresting or sometimes wrong.
Right.
There's no wrongdoing there.
Right.
But when you want to assert a new emergent scientific truth, you cannot link it to a single research result.
Gotcha.
Because we recognize as a community that we can have bias. We're human, like anybody else.
Right.
And I can have bias I didn't know about. So now I do an experiment. David comes in and says, well, you know, I love you, Neil, but let me just double check you. And he gets a different result, finds out I made an error. Or maybe we both made errors and you need a third person to come in and show that. That happens too.
There's publication bias. You get a negative result, you don't publish it because it's not interesting. You get a positive result. Well, if you do anything 20 times, you're likely to get one positive result that's with, you know.
It's even not even true.
It's not even true, right? It's just on the statistical distribution. Right.
Just the fluctuations.
Right. So that's
one
the
of them looks
problem.
Like what you wanted it to be. Right.
So that's
what that.
I like that.
Yeah.
Oh, that looks
it's
good.
It's like, yeah, there we go.
Right.
Skepticism is often weaponized for politically motivated or ideologically motivated points of view. For instance, there are public movements for stopping or limiting the use of fossil fuels due to the widespread evidence, it seems, that fossil fuels, the massive use of fossil fuels all over the world, are causing the climate crisis. But then there are scientists who support the oil industry, they're paid to do so, by being skeptical about this. So objectivity in science, yeah, it's a great idea, but to actually achieve it is maybe not so easy. Scientists are humans, they have their limitations, and pretending that science is completely objective is not objective. Scientists have caged themselves in a box of their own making, made of their own materialistic dogmas. They need to look at themselves. A healer, heal thyself. Materialists are stuck in a unidimensional worldview. What they call science is closed to the possibility of any phenomena beyond the materialistic constraints they have arbitrarily constructed, their own box. And any attempt to go beyond that box, they call pseudoscience and dismiss it. But real science should be open and eager to investigate new possibilities. So what goes on in the name of science is actually pseudoscience, because it's closed to so many possibilities, or even close to things which have been investigated by maverick scientists, just like Rupert Sheldrake with his parapsychology. But they call it pseudoscience, and they won't even bother to investigate it, or they'll just wash it away or forget it. This is another name for this is scientism, a dogma. It closes people's minds to phenomena and ideas outside their experience or their belief. The fundamental mistake that materialistic scientists make is in the belief they hold.
And the people who say, I don't believe in God, I believe in science. It's a belief system which has now been spread to the entire world. But there's a conflict in the heart of science between science as a method of inquiry based on reason, evidence, hypothesis, and collective investigation, and science as a belief system or a worldview. And unfortunately, the worldview aspect of science has come to inhibit and constrict the free inquiry, which is the very lifeblood of the scientific endeavor.
They don't even know that it's a belief. They think it's science. It's so deeply embedded in their consciousness, the Enlightenment rationalist narrative. They, as scientists, they may be not aware of all this philosophy, but it's the Enlightenment rationalist worldview which they've inherited in the name of science, and believing that all of reality is potentially knowable by observation and reason, and that when everything is known, finally, science will have proved that reality has no spiritual dimension and therefore there's no God. Well, already they're saying that. We've already shown there's no need for thinking about God. That might happen. No, it's not going to happen. They're never going to know everything, and they're never going to prove that there isn't any God.